Here's the lineup for the White Sox tonight. Lance Johnson leading off in center field. Sammy Sosa batting second and playing in right field. Yvonne Calderon hitting third and left. Ron Kittle, who had the home run last night for the Sox, in the cleanup spot, the DH. And Carlton Fisk bats fifth behind the plate. Steve Lyons getting a start tonight at first base. Robin Ventura at third. Scott Fletcher at second. Ozzie Guillen is the shortstop, and the hand from the crowd is for Nolan Ryan, who is trotting out to the mound. He'll be pitching against that White Sox lineup.
And defensively, the Rangers have Incavilla, Pettis, and Sierra in the outfield. Kulba, Houston, Franco, and Palmeiro around the horn. And the battery tonight, the Express, Nolan Ryan, and Gino Petralli will catch him. There's a look. I was kind of hoping he wouldn't show up. He was a little late getting out to the mound, Jim.
Yeah, but maybe somebody, he'd get a page or a phone call or something, you know.
Let's try it after this inning. 3-0 is his record on the year. 3.32 is his earned run average. He has pitched in three ball games. No complete games yet. 19 innings, given up only 13 hits, 7 runs, 6 walks, and 17 strikeouts. And the American League, once again, is hitting only 200 against Nolan Ryan so far this year. And they only hit 187 for the entire season last year. Nolan, 16-10 for the Rangers in his comeback to the American League in 32 starts. Led the all of baseball once again in strikeouts with 301 in 239 in the third innings. He just seems to be getting better and better. And as we talked in the pregame, Nolan Ryan, in addition to that great 95 mile an hour plus fastball, he's got an outstanding curveball that can really paralyze both right-handed and left-handed hitters. But he's got that great circle change, and that is a great pitch against the left-hander, because that way that ball will run down and away, and it's used as a great off-speed element for the pitcher.
Here are the umpires tonight. Tim Welke behind the plate. Jim Evans at first, Dale Ford at second, and Drew Coble is at third. Jeff Torborg's club a game over the 500 mark after they halted that four-game losing streak last night. Boy, and what a way to come back. The Bobby Thigpen, who of course was roughed up the night before, he comes back and is the hero the next night.
Isn't that great? I think Bobby, well, Jeff Torborg shows you the kind of confidence he has in his stopper. Bobby Thigpen is his closer. He's going to go with them in a situation where he has a chance to win the ball game. That was a great thing. Also showed the great character the White Sox are developing on that team. They didn't really take that first loss too hard.
That's a good point. Lance Johnson leading off against Nolan Ryan. And the first pitch over, a fastball strike. Ryan with 292 career victories. Certainly 300 within range this year. There's the off speed, 0-2.
That was the circle change right there. Well, that had a great downward movement away from the left-handed hitter. You got to look for his fastball. See the way the release point, you throw it as hard as you can. That's a great off speed pitch. It made Frank Viola a great pitcher because you have the same arm speed as you do with your fastball.
Curveball stays outside. A ball and two strikes to Lance Johnson. The people who will have problems tonight are the outfielders. Heavy rains all day in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. Boy, there was some doubt as whether this game would even be played. That's a tribute to this field that the outfielders do not need pontoons to get around in.
Jim Anglia is the groundskeeper here. He does a great job.
Two balls, two strikes. Johnson strikes out. So that is, what, 5,074?
Give or take a few. Great pitch once again. It's the circle change. Look at it. You know, this is a great pitch for Ryan because on the few nights that he doesn't have that 95, 96 mile an hour fastball, he can resort to this and he can fool a lot of left-handed hitters because basically managers want to put as many left-handers in the lineup against Ryan as they possibly can, try and take advantage of a right, whatever right-left matchup they can possibly muster.
Sammy Sosa the batter. Curveball in there, strike ball.
How'd you like to hit that one?
No, thank you.
Sammy's knees buckled on that one. That pitch started right at his shoulder. Just nasty. Boy, he's got good stuff. You can't say good stuff.
Sammy's got a good series working. Four hits, look at that. Two strikes. The White Sox last year here They roughed up Nolan Ryan. He got the victory. But they played long ball with him.
They had four solo homers off him. They were all crushed. You know, but when he gives up hits, he gives up a lot of solo home runs. He only had six hits on the night.
Two strikeouts in a row for Ryan. He is looking good.
Well, he looks like he's already gotten great command. Usually it takes Nolan an inning or two to establish his strike zone. Right there, that pitch is right on the outside corner. Sammy Sosa completely overmatched after two great curveballs. So he threw him three outstanding pitches in that one at bat.
Two outs, nobody on. Ivan Calderon waves at the curveball.
There's the old hookaroo. Ivan's average, 220, no homers, 7 RBIs. Did have a couple hits last night and is swinging the bat extremely well right now.
The one strike pitch. Boy, he was right there, right where Petrolli set up on the inside. You're right, Tom. He's got great command of everything so far.
Yeah, he's in a good groove right now.
Fastball.
Oh, missed with that one.
Yep.
One of the things you might want to do with Ryan is step out of the batter's box, try and mess up his timing element a little bit, and then he might get mad at you and throw one under your chin, and you don't want that to happen.
Here we go. Two balls and a strike.
Oh, my.
2-2.
There's the changeup. He's not afraid to throw that to right-handed hitters because of the downward movement. Tough to pick up. You really don't see the rotation on that pitch. I know, having hit against Frank Viola over the last few years, since he established that pitch, it is really tough to pick up out of the pitcher's hand, and being able to recognize rotation is one of the real keys in hitting off-speed pitches.
Well, Calderon did step out on him to try to collect his thoughts, fouls it off, so the White Sox do make some contact.
You know, I'm talking with Tommy House before the game, Jim, and Nolan Ryan is clocked. If Nolan Ryan is throwing 95 miles an hour right now, in the ninth inning, if he's still out there,
he'll be at
95 or 94.
Yep. Hard hit ball right at the third baseman, Coolbaugh. And that's it for the Sox. They go in order in the first. After a half inning at Arlington, no score. Pettis leads off for the Rangers. Palmeiro hits second. Then it's Franco, Sierra, Baines, Incaviglia, Petrolli, Coolbaugh, and Jeff Hewson.
And for the White Sox, Calderon, Johnson, and Sosa in the outfield. Ventura, Guillen, Fletcher, Lyons around the horn. Melito Perez and Carlton Fisk, the battery. There's a look at Melito. He's had two real good outings, one not so hot, and that's why his ERA is at 5.63. 1-1's his record. 16 innings pitched, giving up 10 runs, all earned, 15 hits. He struck out 11 while walking only 4, so his control has not been a factor. Early innings have always hurt Melito in the past. Let's see if he can get by this first one unscathed.
Pettis the batter, Ventura playing in at third, a fastball in there for a strike. The numbers on Gary Pettis in the early season. Pettis, of course, has had a career, at least from an offensive standpoint, where that old saying that you can't steal first, and if he could, he'd really be dangerous. He's starting to raise that average some in recent years. Defensively, of course, one of the top outfielders in all of baseball. Fouled off.
Well, you know what? He's scuffling a little bit, I think, defensively, and it probably is so far because of the vicious winds that are kind of circling around Arlington Stadium so far this season, Jim. He really hadn't been that impressive defensively for the Rangers, but he has had, as you mentioned, a just terrific career in the outfield, center field, both for California and Detroit.
Melito Perez ahead in the count, the 1-2, and it gets away from Fisk, and the throw gets away from Lyons. Melito Perez will get credit for a strikeout, however, no put out on the play.
Well, we're probably going to see a pass ball. The split finger pitch, great pitch by Melito. Look at that thing go down and away, and it hit right on the heel of Carl Fisk's glove. Pudge goes over to try and make the play, the off-balance throw. It is slippery out there. All the grass is very slippery. They've got him, I believe. Lyons just can't come up with it, although he was in foul ground, and that was the right place to catch that ball. to give himself the best opportunity. I would say that'll be called a pass ball. And that gives Pettis with great speed at first base and Palmeiro. Two things complicated here. Pettis with the great speed can steal second base, and Palmeiro can take advantage of that hole between first and second.
Perez holding him close. Gary Pettis has three stolen bases already. Palmeiro off to a good start with the Rangers. At 358 mark in the top 10 in the American League. Pettis stays, and the pitch misses low. Ball one, the count on Rafael Palmeiro.
Yeah, Carlton Fisk was doing such a nice job the other night, Jim, catching that knuckleball from Eric King with that small glove. So I'm a bit surprised that the split finger pitch got away from him on that particular one, although it was just outstanding. That thing went down and away. Pettis had no chance.
Steve Lyons with a start tonight, playing at first base. He spent some time there Monday. He also spent some time at all the other positions on Monday. Well, in the Windy City Classic against the Cubs.
Yes, he did. He took an 0 for that night. Hopefully he won't do the same, but Steve Lyons, good fastball hitter.
Pettis on the way. Fisk delivers. They got him. Gary Pettis thrown out trying to steal.
Great job of throwing there by Carlton Fisk, but also a good job by Melido Perez, because Gary Pettis did not get a good jump there. See, right there, he was not off as quick as he normally is, and there you see Pudge just guns him down.
That's
easily
a perfect throw.
Good job both ways by Perez and Fisk.
So one out and nobody on. The 2-0 delivery. Ball three, no strikes.
You can't outrun the gun. Carlton Fisk has done that a few times in his career, but Pettis, one of the better base stealers in the American League.
Although early on, he's 50-50. There's ball four.
Boy, that was a big one.
A big caught stealing indeed. Here's Franco.
Well, that thing is huge right now, Jim, because instead of first and second with your three and four hitters, and I'll tell you what, this 3-4 with Franco and Sierra, to me, ranks with any 3-4 combination in not only the American League, with all of baseball. Those, throw out those numbers on Julio Franco. He's a 300 hitter. He's hit 300 four consecutive years.
Franco batting with one out and one on. Perez struck out Pettis, but when the ball got away from Fisk, Pettis reached. The other way, out of play. Julio Franco, who hit over 300 last season in the American League, also hit well against the White Sox, 342.
Franco hits everybody good, though. He's 315 career hitter against the White Sox and 308 at bats. Three homers, 34 RBIs. Most of that done when he was with the Cleveland Indians.
So he's up there now with Palmeiro at first and one out. Inside and low. A ball and a strike.
Don't you just love his stance?
I was going to say, you put on that pitching clinic when we came on the air tonight. This would be how, this would be teaching a youngster how not to bat, right?
Don't try this at home, kids.
Right.
He's got two fingers in his left hand over the knob of the bat. For leverage, uses a 35-inch, 35-ounce bat. So you can tell how strong he is. He wraps the bat completely around his head and gets a great swing every time. You figure it out.
Perez missing inside.
He gets to that hitting zone, though, and that's a key for Julio. You know, he tried to be a conventional hitter and couldn't hit a lick. So he decided, heck, if it doesn't look good, that still doesn't mean anything. He gets to the zone properly. Plus, he's very strong, as you can see by his forearms and shoulders. This is a strong man.
Great clutch hitter, too. Probably as good a clutch hitter as you'll run across.
Yeah, you know, the White Sox have that good scouting report on all the teams. Look where Ventura is playing third base. He's almost at the shortstop position. He does not pull the ball on the ground, obviously.
Way out in front on a let-up, and it's ball two, strike two. Here's a look at Robin Ventura, well off the line. over toward the hole.
And moving closer to the hole. He's playing him like a left-handed pull hitter. And what that circle change does for Nolan Ryan, the split finger fastball does for Melido Perez, that is a great off-speed pitch for Melido. And ever since about the middle of last year when he started taking a lot off of that pitch, he became a much better pitcher.
Melido Perez has split two decisions so far in this young season. His earned run average is high, though, at 5.63. And he's been giving up almost a hit an inning. Franco chases it out of the strike zone, but he strikes out swinging. That's two strikeouts for Perez.
Well, Melido Perez is really establishing himself, as Nolan Ryan did in the top half of this inning. Look at this split finger pitch down. Started off actually outside, came over the outside corner, and just completely fooled a great hitter in Julio Franco. So there's two outs for Sierra.
And another great hitter to deal with, Ruben Sierra. Perez taking his time here in this first inning. You had to wonder if he was upset by getting that strikeout with Pettis and then having him reach, but Carlton Fisk helped bail him out, getting Pettis on that attempted steal. Now ball low. Palmeiro, the runner at first. He's there with a walk. Steve Lyons not holding him. So Sierra doesn't have that whole big gap over there on the right side to hit through. The 1-0 pitch to Sierra. No swing. Ball two.
Well, Melito's almost going strictly with the split finger pitch so far, Jim. He has great command of it, although Sierra did a good job of holding off that pitch. Now he's 2-0. He might have to come in with a fastball because you still have the dangerous hitter in Harold Baines on deck.
Ruben Sierra had the big ninth inning homer the other night. Outside, ball three.
All right, you're the manager. You let him swing here. 3-0.
Baines is up next. Well, I'd have him swing here.
Yep.
Here's a 3-0. Way wide. So far, it is feast or famine for Melido Perez. Two strikeouts, two walks. And here's Harold Baines.
Well, you're right. He's either made great pitches or he's made, you know, bad pitches way out of the zone. To Palmeiro and Sierra, he really didn't come close. But to the other hitters that he faced, he was really nasty. So Harold Baines with an early RBI opportunity. Harold scuffling early on. You see that 205 batting average, two homers, eight RBIs, but he's liable to erupt at any time.
Two base runners, the results of walks. And the first pitch to Baines is hammered down to second. Fletcher has it, and the Rangers are retired in the first inning. Texas, no hits, two walks, two left. After an inning, no score in Arlington. DH and cleanup hitter Ron Kittle leads off the second inning against Nolan Ryan. Kittle takes the fastball in there for a strike. Kittle hit the home run last night, a two-run homer. Boy, like last year, he's off to a good start. Kittle, who was doing very well a year ago before that injury sidelined him, fouls this one back. Two strikes to count.
Kitty swinging the bat very well. After the first couple ball games, I think he has been on most of the time, most of the pitches that are thrown to him. And, you know, he didn't really catch fire until after about 3 weeks into
last season.
Jim,
it was in May where he really took off.
Right. And he put the team on his back for a couple weeks. Very unfortunate. Oh, look out. Almost ducked right into that curveball. And he started off behind him. Kitty.
So, one and
yeah,
two.
He's got a curveball. I'll tell you what, Ron Kittle's swinging the bat better now than when he was rookie of the year, way back.
It's the breaking ball into right field. Just got that ball over Palmeiro. So there goes the no-hitter tonight for Nolan Ryan.
Well, it wasn't pretty. It wasn't a pretty swing. It was a curveball. There you see what Ron Kittle did against the Rangers. 7-for-13. That averages out to 538. Fletcher very good at 360. Gallagher not playing tonight, 333. And Calderon at 327. Tell you what, you looked like Palmeiro got his legs crossed up going for that thing. You know, Kittle hit that ball off the end of the bat, and the thing had a real funny spin coming of it at him. And Palmeiro didn't judge it properly. Probably should have made the play.
So you've got Carlton Fisk facing Nolan Ryan. You got a couple guys who have been around the block a few times in this matchup, and a strike call to Fisk.
Great curveball right there. Of course, Carlton Fisk has gone down on strikes to Nolan Ryan 21 times during his great career.
Yeah, but he's probably faced him as often 100. As anybody.
Over 100, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, my.
And again, the breaking ball is in there. Two strikes to count.
Well, that curveball is so good from Ryan because you don't pick up the rotation. He likes to start it at the hitters. So not only does he get the strike, but he also humiliates you at the same time because your knees and everything just buckle.
You know, it's almost as if, too, Tom, tonight he's showing two different curveballs. He showed that one roundhouse curve to Kittle, and now he gets Fisk on strikes. That's three strikeouts for Ryan.
And Pudge, I know, I'd have taken all three of them too. Pray to be ball three. Hope he throws the ball with. There you see it coming. It actually wasn't that good of a pitch. That's a hanging breaking ball. But the key to that pitch, Jim, is the fact that the rotation is so good it looks like a fastball until the last second, and then it breaks.
So Steve Lyons the batter. That 333 average for Lyons is on the strength of one out of three in pinch hitting appearances.
Ooh.
Barely missed, ball one the count.
The Lyons basically in the lineup because he is a good fastball hitter. He can hit just about any fastball, and I think that that is why Ryan started him off with that curveball.
The bunt is foul. The White Sox come home for the weekend. The Toronto Blue Jays are in town at Comiskey Park, and today Cleveland defeated Toronto 4-3. So the Blue Jays will come in with an 11-6 record, and Kelly Gruber, boy, he is as hot as anybody in baseball. He's doing a great Mike Schmidt impression, isn't he?
Oh.
Seven home runs already.
At least Schmidt. Maybe George Herman Ruth impression. He's got seven home runs, just putting Toronto on his back. Of course, he's got a great supporting cast there, too. You know, the key is when you're going to have a great year, you got to have other people around you having good years because they can't pitch around Kelly Gruber.
That's
George
true.
Bell, McGriff hitting around him. Those are outstanding players.
1-1 to Lyons with one out. Breaking ball in the dirt. Did he swing? He did. One ball and two strikes.
I agree with you too, Jim, on that curveball theory of yours. He's throwing one hard one, as you saw right there, and the other one a little bit slower.
There was some talk that Nolan Ryan would be in politics at this stage of his life about a year ago, that he would become involved in Texas politics here, the agriculture commissioner.
Mm-hmm.
That one gets away from Petrolli, and down to second goes Kittle. But he feels, of course, that while he can continue to produce the way he can, that he's going to stick around, and he is showing no sign at all of decreasing in efficiency in any way as far as pitching goes.
Well, he's already signed a contract to come back next year. Got a pretty good raise, I understand.
Yeah.
So Ryan will be back. They're going to canonize him too, once he retires. That pitch right there, a little bit deceptive. Wild pitch is going to be ruled on that last fastball to Steve Lyons.
That moves Kittle up into scoring position with one out. And the 2-2. Hit on the right side, it moves Kittle over, and Palmeiro makes the play unassisted.
And he got another out with that circle change. He will use that a lot to the left-handed hitters, not so much to the right-handers. If he's going to throw it to a right-hander, I think he's got to keep it down and out of the strike zone. But to a lefty, it's a very effective pitch.
And now the White Sox third baseman Robin Ventura has a chance to look at Nolan Ryan. Robin Ventura's batting average on the slide. He's hitless on the road trip so far.
I believe Robin's last hit was that home run against Roger Clemens last week at Comiskey Park.
Boy, he really nailed that one.
Yes, he did.
Fastball sails high. Ball one to Ventura.
Well, the one thing that Robin Ventura has shown in his brief major league career is he will accept a walk. He's got a great eye at the plate.
Ball one, no strikes. Fastball high again. Ball two.
Watch Nolan Ryan tonight, too. I might as well mention this early, Jim, that he gets very few breaks from the umpires. As great a pitcher as he is, they make him almost throw to a teacup at times.
Yeah, but he's missed with three pitches well out of the strike zone here to Ventura. 3-0. Ryan not only is the all-time strikeout leader, but he also in his career has issued more walks than any other pitcher.
He's thrown a lot more pitches than anybody else either, that's for sure.
The 3-0 pitch. Fastball in there.
That one had some pop to it. There's no doubt about it. You know, he's not the biggest guy in the world either. They list him at what, 6'2 and 210 pounds. Great condition though. And he gets all his power from his legs.
Yes. Pop foul. Out of play off to the left. So the count is full to Robin Ventura. Nolan Ryan back in the American League last year. Had a 1-0 record against the White Sox and an earned run average of 4.5. But he amassed quite a record during his tenure with the California Angels back in the 1970s against the White Sox. Full count pitch, curveball, lined foul.
Well, here's a guy, too, Jim, who struck out 301 batters last year in the American League when it's if you strike out 200 in this league, you've done a great job because you're not facing that pitcher anymore in the lineup like you do in the National League. And so to me, that is just incredible. Against the White Sox, look at that, 19-13.
That would be a great season, right?
Oh, terrific. Over a strikeout an inning, too.
Yep.
How about that?
That's in his career. And, of course, most of those numbers, as I mentioned, he accumulated while with the California Angels back in the 70s. You know, Nolly, too, has usually pitch for weak hitting clubs. The California Angels in those days, they were not a strong hitting team. Strike three call. Four strikeouts for Ryan. The White Sox go down in the second. No runs, a hit, and a man left. And after 1.5, no score. Beautiful Texas sunset. With our producer-director, Skip Ellison, this is Jim Durham with Tom Pishorek here in Arlington. Pete Incaviglia ready to lead off against Melido Perez here in the home second. Got quite a strikeout derby working right now. Nolan Ryan with four strikeouts, and Perez struck out two in his first inning of work. Incaviglia hitting right at the 300 mark. Fouls it off.
Incaviglia, as you see right there, big, strong guy. Swinging the bat very well this year so far. What Bobby Valentine wants from this guy is some production, some power numbers.
Well, he's getting them. Four homers, 14 runs batted in.
Yeah, that's about an RBI a ball game. So those are great, but he needs about 30 homers and about 100 RBIs from this guy.
Hammers that one. Ventura, great pickup. The throw in time.
Oh my, Robin Ventura once again. He goes to his left, great. He goes to his right extremely well, as he shows you right here. What a play on Incaviglia, who runs down the line very well for a big guy. Bobby Valentine trying to restrain him over there, Jim, but I think he got him.
I do, too.
Holy mackerel. Let's see this again. Look at this.
And even if he didn't, because of the play, I'd give it to him.
Look at this. Look at this.
Out.
Out. He is out by about 6 inches. My goodness, what a play. I don't like sliding in the first base. I think Inky may have lost a split second right there. Nonetheless, great play, Ventura.
Gino Petrolli fouls it off into the Texas dugout.
I think he's lucked that ball. It hit him right upside the head. You can see right down the line, Ventura's playing off the line because he's not a pull hitter, per se. There you see him. He just gets him. I think that sliding in the first base slows you down a little bit.
You may be right.
You really got it almost Carl Lewis at first base. Get your body all the way forward and like you're going, you know, to the tape in a race. There's Bobby V. And before I forget, Bobby wanted to say hi to his mom and dad, Grace and Joe Valentine, watching the game in Stamford, Connecticut. And
howdy, Valentine.
Eggplant Parmesan is great.
This time, Carlton Fisk makes the throw down to first. And the strikeout and the putout are recorded as Petrolli goes down on strikes.
Another split finger punch kept that one in front of him. You know, Bobby Valentine's mom makes the greatest eggplant maybe in the world.
You would know that.
Yes. America's guest knows all. I let Bob have a little bit of it, too.
I'll bet you did. You didn't stop by and have a bite to eat before you came to work tonight, did you?
Yeah, just a bite.
Coolbaugh, the batter. And the 2 outs and nobody on. Fastball a little high. Ball one. I'll tell you what, Thomas, we got the makings of a good one here tonight.
Good pitchers duel so far. Got their strikeout pitches working. Plus,
good defense, too.
Oh, my.
Huh?
Robin Ventura.
He's going to make the. He's already in the highlight film for this year.
Yeah.
More than once. Strike. He swung at it. Jim Evans, the first base umpire, not very popular right now at Arlington Stadium.
He's the crew chief. Let's take a look at it. Split finger. Oh, my. Look at that thing go down. Yeah. Looks like he went from here.
1-1. Strike called. 1 ball and 2 strikes. Well, the White Sox come home and play the Toronto Blue Jays this weekend. Texas starts a road trip tomorrow in Kansas City. They play the Royals the weekend, and then the Rangers will be at Comiskey Park next week. Hit hard, but Ozzie's got it. And Guillen throws out Coolbaugh, and the Rangers go down in order in the second. 3 up and 3 down, and after 2 full, no score. We have a Blackhawks sweater in the audience tonight. The Blackhawks with a big one against the St. Louis Blues in Chicago Stadium this evening. Phillips 66 and WGN-TV are donating 4 box seats to every Sox home game in April to the Off the Street Club, Chicago's oldest boys and girls club. Scotty Fletcher leading off for the White Sox here in the third. Curveball stays high. Phillips 66, the White Sox, and Channel 9 are honored to support the Off the Street Club in its work to provide more than 3,000 West Side Chicago kids an alternative to gangs, drugs, and crime. If you have a chance to help a kid, don't pass it up. Fastball inside corner, 1-1. We're told the Blackhawks and the Blues scoreless after one. One ball and one strike. Scott Fletcher standing in. Fastball, pop foul.
And while we're talking about Chicago sports, Jim, how about the Bulls opening game tomorrow night?
Opening game for them tomorrow night in the NBA playoffs, Milwaukee Bucks in Chicago Stadium. I'll tell you what, Tom, if ever a team was set up, it's the Bulls, and I say that in this regard. They have so dominated Milwaukee in recent seasons, winning 17 of the last 19 games played. And if ever a team could be overconfident going in, it would be the Bulls.
I would think so.
And that's not good.
Just like the White Sox have dominated the Brewers in the last 2 years.
Fletcher lays off. It's 2-2.
Scotty is scuffling. He's 3 for 35 right now. 086 is his batting average. He's going to come out of it. Just needs a couple good games back to back. Get that good confidence going.
Let's see what Nolan does here on a 2-2. Fastball in on the fist, and it's fouled out of play. This series with the Texas Rangers is the first time the White Sox have played in the American League West. And they'll be back in the East over the weekend with the Toronto Blue Jays in town. The White Sox going for the series victory here tonight in this third rubber game. 3-2 pitch. Ball four. Scott Fletcher, the second base runner.
Well, that's the first walk on the night for Nolan Ryan. Scotty Fletcher with a good at bat. He really battled him, got him to 3-2, and he threw the high fastball. So Ozzie Guillen, the hitter, and Jeff Torborg has at his disposal a number of alternatives. Nolan Ryan not very good at holding runners on at first base. Has a tendency to get a lot of stolen base. Of course, you don't get to first base that often with Nolan. You can also hit and run with Ozzie being a great contact hitter. Scotty doesn't have any stolen bases yet. Let's see what Jeff has up his sleeve.
Palmeiro holding Fletcher at first. Bunt, pushed, foul.
Okay, little ball is what Jeff Torborg has in mind. He probably feels that Melido Perez has outstanding stuff tonight. And he has a chance to match Nolan Ryan pitch for pitch, but you really can't expect the White Sox to get a couple of hits back to back in order to score that run from first base. So sacrifice is a nice alternative to that. But with the runner at first, you should make the first baseman field the bunt.
Yeah, but it's tough to pull even on a bunt against
yeah.
Ryan.
I didn't say it was going to be easy.
Ideally, in a bunting situation this way, the pitcher wants to keep the ball up.
Yes.
So that they pop it up. Curveball.
See?
Two strikes on Guillen.
But when you got that kind of yellow hammer, you don't have to throw the high fastball. Boy, I'll tell you, that's a tough pitch to bunt because that thing is looks like a fastball, and all of a sudden it just the bottom drops out on it. Looks like he's got like a Don Sutton. Remember Don Sutton's curveball?
Yeah.
That's pretty close to what Nolan has right now.
Now Guillen has a rip and lifts a fly ball into shallow left. Houston backs out, gives way to Incavilla.
That's what you got to do. Call that guy off. The outfielder certainly has a better approach to the ball. He can see it a lot better because he's coming in. The infielder going back. It's a tough play, especially on the wet turf. You know, Incavilla surprisingly runs very well for a big guy.
See the water splashing up around the the feet of the ball players. That outfield is so waterlogged.
But it's in a lot better shape than most places would be under the circumstances.
That's true. So Lance Johnson, the batter. He struck out leading off the game, and it's one strike the count. Nolan Ryan, in his first outing, which was opening day, pitched a no-hitter through five against Toronto. Then left the game. Last season, he had five no-hitters into the eighth and beyond. He lost three in the eighth, lost two in the ninth. Strike two to Lance Johnson. And of course, there's been a long time between no-hitters for him. He had his fifth one in 1981 with the Houston Astros. And his first no-hitter, Jeff Torborg, caught it. Isn't that a small world?
Yeah. And Jeff went over to, they had a dinner Monday night over here at the Arlington Convention Center. Jeff went over there to visit with Nolan. They were raising money for Abilene Christian getting back into collegiate baseball.
Johnson strikes out. That's five strikeouts for Ryan, and the second time Johnson has gone down.
Same pitch that Lance struck out in the first inning. Circle change, remember that. Oh my, teach your kids how to throw that pitch because it's such a, you know, it's got such great arm action. He does anyway. And of course, everybody that's had success with it does too. You just throw that ball as hard as you can, but you can't possibly, the way you fit it in your hand, you can't possibly put a whole lot of velocity on the ball.
So now Sammy Sosa, the batter. The White Sox in jeopardy of wasting a leadoff walk to Fletcher. Here in the third. Swing and a miss. Johnson and Sosa, they've got to be talking to themselves right now.
How about Fisk? Those three nasty curveballs that back to back to back. He didn't even waste a pitch. You're talking about a Hall of future Hall of Famer there in Carlton Fisk.
Yeah, but another one was throwing it.
You got it. Yeah, that's right.
That was usually a Cooperstown matchup, right?
That's right. Usually it's advantage pitcher under those circumstances.
Up high, Fletcher on the move. The throw is high, but they've got him. Scotty Fletcher thrown out trying to steal. And that ends the third for the White Sox. After 2.5, no score. Well, the Texas Rangers with the presidential seal of approval, you might say. George W. Bush, the managing general partner, sitting in.
He's a great guy. A lot of fun. I'll tell you, they enjoy playing for him. Bobby Valentine likes him. Tom Grieve. It was a good move when his group bought the Rangers last year.
Strike one to Jeff Houston, who leads off for Texas here in the third. Up high, one ball and one strike.
You know, last year around the batting cage, Jim, we were all sitting around. Bobby Valentine asked George what he felt like about jewelry on his ball players, and if he thought that earrings would be okay for the players to wear. And he said, definitely not. That's part of our policy. We will not have that. And he says, well, Bobby said, was he? Here's a pitch on the outside corner by Melido. And Bobby says, well, what about that earring that Ruben Sierra has in his right ear? And George says, well, we may have to change Ranger policy. So he's very flexible.
He heard you.
He says, earrings are all right, as long as Ruben has it. Or
on another topic, I noticed broccoli being served in the press room.
Yes.
It is ball two, strike two to Houston. So evidently, this George Bush doesn't mind.
Right.
Melido Perez with a count of 2-2 on Houston. Ozzie Guillen charging. Nice play.
And the first in a series of Shy Sox Coca-Cola luncheons will take place on Monday, April 30th at noon at the Chicago Hilton and Towers downtown. Luncheon will feature the entire White Sox team. For more information, call 312-924-1000, extension 365. To order tickets, call Ticketmaster at 312-559-1212.
Gary Pettis, 0-for-1. One of the three strikeout victims. Fastball in there. In the first inning, Melido really had trouble with the fastball, getting it in the strike zone. So much so that it appeared, at least from up here, that he stayed away from it quite a bit. He did walk two in that inning. Ball one, strike one. 67 degrees, it says. Very comfortable evening.
Beautiful evening for baseball. Best night we've had here, although it was just raining like daylights all day today. There's the ball up high. 2-1 now on Pettis. Last two nights, Jim, the wind was just howling straight in from center field, which means that the ball will be carrying out, which just sounds kind of crazy. But at Arlington Stadium, when the wind blows in, kind of has that circular effect, and it will turn it back around. So line drives will carry out of this ballpark.
2-2 on Pettis. There's virtually no wind tonight. The flags in center field hanging limp. Here's the 2-2 from Perez. Struck him out. That is six in a row retired by Melido.
Four strikeouts. Rangers will strike out as a team. There you see good old-fashioned hardball played by Melido Perez right there. He just blows the fastball right by Gary Pettis. And Pettis has had that problem throughout his career. Strikeouts for an leadoff hitter is not a very good thing. Rangers 115 strikeouts now, 113 with that last one as a team. That's a lot.
Ball one, the count to Palmeiro. In this series, the White Sox starting pitching has been pretty good.
Oh, Eric King was terrific on the first night. Jack McDonald did a nice job last night, too.
And Perez doing a good job so far, a ball and a strike.
Melito's 0-5 against the Rangers in his career, but has had some real tough luck. 3.72 is his earned run average against his team.
Two of those losses were last year when his earned run average was higher than that at 5.84. And coming into this game tonight, in 16 innings of work, he had allowed 15 hits. So far, no hits. 2-1. Ball three, strike one.
Well, a favorable count here for Palmeiro. Here's a chance where he probably should get a fastball here. You don't want to face Franco. Give yourself a chance to get this guy out. And of course, Palmeiro, with two out and nobody on, has got to be thinking extra base.
He hits the outside pitch and he pulls it down to second. Fletcher takes care of Palmeiro. And the Rangers go 1-2-3 in the third. After three full, it's still nothing, nothing. Sammy Sosa ready to lead off for the Sox here in the fourth against Nolan Ryan. White Sox with one hit. And that was a ball hit off the end of the bat by Ron Kittle that he just dumped over Palmeiro at first base. The only hit of the game, fastball outside. Season tickets for this season still available, including the popular 20-game winner plan. The 20-game winner plan allows you to select any 22 games on the White Sox schedule for the price of 20, including the last weekend in Comiskey Park. Plenty of good locations remain. Good location there from Nolan Ryan. Sammy Sosa, who was up there batting in the third when Fletcher was thrown out trying to steal, getting another look at Ryan here. For more information on those season ticket plans, call the White Sox office at 312-924-1000. The 1-1 pitch. He barely got a piece to that one. Just to get an idea, I wonder if anyone has a radar gun on Ryan right now.
Yeah, they do.
What he's throwing.
Yeah, the Rangers put the gun on every pitch by their team and the opposition. They're a little faster than most, so Ryan is probably registering about 96, 97 on their gun.
We understand he's throwing in the low 90s. 91, 92. There it is.
Yeah. And that's what your friendly highway patrolmen are using to time you.
Curveball low. Ball two, strike two.
So remember that, James, when you're on our lovely freeways.
No, I don't speed. I don't have a car or a truck that will go that fast. Sosa fouls it off. It's still 2-2. Big crowd here tonight. The largest crowd so far in the series.
Oh, yeah, it's about twice as big as it was last
night
two nights.
11,600 and some. And
other night, I think, was 13, little over 13,000. Yeah. But Ryan does that. He has that effect. People come to watch him pitch.
2-2. Got a fastball by Sosa. That's six.
There you see it. Good old-fashioned hard ball by Nolan Ryan. Boy, that ball took off. Man, he cut that ball inside. Actually didn't cut it, but that almost had the effect. Although it didn't sink very much, it just broke into the right-handed hitter. Another dimension to the fastball.
Fastball gets by Calderon.
My. You know, actually, when you consider that he's cutting his fastball like that, making the ball move just straight into a right-handed hitter, Jim, he's got about He's actually throwing four or five different pitches rather than just the three that we talked about earlier. Oh my.
He's getting away with pitches
miles an hour.
He's getting away with pitches up now, Tom.
Oh yeah? He's not getting away with anything.
You know that he's not at 91 or 92
now.
Oh,
no way. He's in the high 90s with that one anyway.
Two strikes to count on Calderon.
What's this?
Curveball. Seven strikeouts.
That's not fun. He gets ahead of you in the count, and it is see you later. That is Uncle Charlie, Sir Charles, or whatever you want to call this curveball. It is nasty. Watch Calderon buckle right here. Oh, my. Bye. Tough. Let's look at it again. This is your worst nightmare. You think that ball is heading right at your shoulder about 95 miles an hour, and then it hits the outside corner at the knees. See you later.
Fastball rides inside. You know, for a few seasons, I had the privilege to do some games in Houston when Nolan was there, and we always had a saying on the crew whenever Nolan walked out to the mound. The one thing that he always said is, if I get my curveball over, well, when he gets the curveball over, boy, you've got no shot. And he's been getting it over tonight.
Yeah, he really has. Great command of that curveball. And he, like I said, he likes to use the right-handed hitter as a target. Throw it at the guy and use that as the basis because he has such a sharp and a big break to that pitch. Throw it at him and break it on over.
1-1 to Kittle. Just got a piece of it. One ball and two strikes.
I remember trying to hit off of Nolan Ryan's curveball. I just was not going to stick around to see if that thing was going to break. If it was at me, I was gone.
Well, he only struck you out twice.
Right.
We've got the whole list here in the Ranger book.
He didn't hit me. I guess that's all I know.
Okay, 1-2 to Kittle.
Oh my.
A little check swing, and again he hits it the other way. This time Palmeiro has the play unassisted. Three up and three down for the White Sox in the fourth. 3.5 innings of great pitching both ways in this scoreless game.
No score at Arlington, and while we have a moment, the first 15,000 fans attending the White Sox-Blue Jays game on Friday, April 27th at 7:05 will receive a collectible photo of Carlton Fisk. Compliments of Kodak. For tickets, call Ticketmaster at 312-559-1212.
Julio Franco ready to lead off for the Rangers in the fourth. Perez struck him out in the first inning. Melido Perez threw three innings. Three strikeouts, two walks. No hits. Talking about no hits, earlier today on Channel 9, Mike Harkey took a no-hitter into the eighth. Lost the no-hitter and the shutout, but won the game as the Cubs beat the Padres 3-1. The 1-0 to Franco.
Oh my.
That split finger is really dropping. One ball and one strike.
You know, Melito Perez came into this ball game, Jim, with a 5.63 earned run average, but he had two great starts. His first two ball games were outstanding. In Cleveland, he didn't have command of either his fastball or his split finger pitch, so that's why he gave up six runs in three and a third inning. And that's why his ERA is so inflated.
Franco waves at another one. One ball and two strikes.
Franco's just not picking up the rotation of that split finger pitch. Of course, that's another pitch where it looks like a fastball till it gets right to home plate, and then the bottom drops out. And you have to be disciplined to take that pitch, or else you're going to look real bad like Julio did on that last swing.
Perez ahead in the count, the 1-2. Got him. Second time in the game, Franco has struck out.
Five strikeouts for Perez, and he swung at three pitches out of the strike zone. Look at it. Split finger. Goodbye. Boy, Julio had no chance right there. His head really flew. Those two at-bats tonight against Melito is about as the two worst at bats I think I've ever seen Franco have.
So now Ruben Sierra, the batter, with one out and nobody on. This is a key inning for Perez because he has to go through this tough part of the order here for the Rangers.
Oh my.
Oh boy. Strike one to Sierra. If he gets through this inning in good shape, Tom, he's in for a long run tonight, I feel.
Oh yeah, no doubt about it. He has really in the groove. Of course, the Rangers, they have that ability to explode on you. And they also have that thing about striking out too. That's why Melito, if he can keep the ball down there, he'll get a lot of strikeouts.
1-1, the count to Sierra. Yeah, the White Sox know firsthand about the Rangers exploding on them, as they did here Tuesday night, wiping out that four-run lead in the ninth. The 1-1 got the outside corner, a ball and two strikes.
There's that earring that we were talking about earlier that will change Ranger team policy in regards to jewelry on their players.
One and two. Sierra asked for time. In the National League today, Pittsburgh won again. They beat the Giants 2-1. Giants have not won yet in Candlestick Park.
0-8. And they're just not playing good baseball right now. Pitching staff might be getting a little old.
High fly ball, left center. Calderon doesn't have to move very far for that one. Well, the next telecast of White Sox baseball on Channel 9, Sunday afternoon at Comiskey Park. The Toronto Blue Jays are in town. And then the following weekend, May 4th and 5th, at Kansas City. And then the Yankees on May 22nd in New York. The next four telecasts coming up on Channel 9.
That was the first fly ball out that Melito has gotten, so you know the split finger's been working.
Oh, and a comebacker. He's going to get Baines. And another 1-2-3 inning for Melido Perez. He is looking good, and so is Ryan in this scoreless game. A fireworks display sponsored by Coca-Cola will take place after the White Sox meet the Blue Jays this Saturday, April 28th at 6. For tickets, call Ticketmaster at 312-559-1212. And remember, it's only a 35-minute ride to convenient Comiskey Park from Elmhurst. Melido Perez and Nolan Ryan in a scoreless duel as this game moves on to the top of the fifth. Carlton Fisk ready to lead off for the Sox. And yes, Nolan Ryan got him on strikes in the second.
Well, he just paralyzed Pudge three straight pitches with curveballs. Didn't waste a fastball. Let's see how he approaches it this time. Carlton Fisk has that ability to adjust, though, to any type of pitcher. Of course, he's got to get something to hit, though. Those last three pitches were just too nasty. Fastball.
That's the call, and there's a long foul.
Oh, Gino Petrolli wanted that pitch away, and he got it on the inside part of the plate. And as we've seen in the past, Jim, Carlton Fisk can pull anybody's inside fastball.
Some of the scores of other games going on in the American League. Seattle Mariners trying to win again in New York. Brian Holman getting a win there yesterday. As we told you, Cleveland defeated the Blue Jays today, 4-3. And Milwaukee over Kansas City. One strike to count on Carlton Fisk.
Wants the fastball away again.
Barely got a piece of it. We told you the Giants losing this afternoon at home, the Cubs. In that game seen earlier on Channel 9, winning in San Diego. And the Astros, a 3-0 winner over Atlanta. Two strikes on Fisk. you talked about earlier, Tom Fisk stepping out to try to break up the rhythm of Ryan. It's 1-2.
Well, you have to do something. Of course, Pudge takes his sweet old time every at bat. Nolan Ryan is no exception. He will not vary in what he does in every at bat. I'd look for that curveball right now. I wouldn't look for it if I was hitting, but right now, sitting up here, I think the curveball's coming. Nope.
Hit on the fist and pull foul.
See, Nolan is thinking here that Pudge is thinking along with him that I got him on three consecutive curveballs, so he might be sitting on that pitch. So Nolan, kind of a guessing game out there right now with, see, as we mentioned earlier, two future Hall of Famers battling it out here at Arlington.
1-2. Got him with the curve.
Well, I kind of felt like he'd throw him one sooner or later in this at bat. Pudge goes down for the second time. You can see this one. Nasty. Down and away. He was out of the strike zone, but it's just something you just have to be almost too disciplined up there to not take a whack at that pitch. So there's one out for Steve Lyons.
Lyons grounded out to Rafael Palmeiro unassisted. Strike call. Nolan Ryan trying for his fourth consecutive victory. And should he get it tonight, it would be his best start since 1975 when he went 4-0 out of the box with the Angels. Two strikes on Lyons. Steve Lyons called out on strikes.
I'll tell you one thing. I'm so glad that we're up here and not down on that field trying to hit either one of these two pitchers tonight. Here you see one of the nastier breaking balls you'll ever see. Steve Lyons is committing to the fastball, as you can see right there. He's striding. Oops. Hands did not stay back. Really didn't have a chance to hit that curveball. And Steve is saying that that pitch is low. Possibility, though.
Robin Ventura takes the breaking ball inside.
That pitch is very difficult to hit if you're a Walt Riniak type hitter, because you're going down, going out. They're trying to protect against the outside corner. Tendency is to swing over the top of a curveball, over the breaking ball that's coming down and into a left-handed hitter.
Nolan Ryan with two strikes on Ventura. This is as good as Ryan has been all season in the early stages of 1990. Two balls and a strike. In fact, in his last outing against the Yankees, he worked seven innings. He left the game due to cramps in his right thigh, but he didn't show any problem with that between starts.
Well, I don't think anything's hurting him right
Nothing.
Now.
Oh, a little bit high, a little bit outside, perhaps. Three balls and a strike.
You think Robin Ventura's already got that reputation as having a great eye? That's why that pitch wasn't called a strike?
Maybe so. Fastball popped up, foul, and out of play. 3-2.
Tell you what, this is about as calm a night as I've ever seen in Texas. Coming to Arlington for the last 10 or 12 years, I mean, it's always windy here. Probably the windiest place in the country. There's some White Sox fans.
Yeah, we've got some Chicagoans here, all right.
But with that, I'm just interested to see how well the ball's going to carry tonight, Jim, but we just haven't seen anybody hit the ball well yet.
Well, one fly ball to left comes to mind, and that's about it. Here's the 3-2 pitch to Ventura. Stays alive.
We can't hear it, but I know Nolan Ryan gave it his usual on that delivery. You can usually hear it all around the ballpark. This guy is one of the greatest competitors also that's ever played the game.
Again, the 3-2 pitch to Ventura. Ball four. Good eye.
pitches. I just don't know how you can take a pitch this close unless you really don't see it. And that's probably about 94 mile an hour right on the knees. Probably, yeah, it was a little bit low. Robin Ventura once again gets on base. He's not swinging the bat too well right now, but he's still getting his share of walks. He's going to be something.
That's the second walk given up by Ryan in the game, and the other one was to Scott Fletcher, who bats with two out and a man on. Strike call. Nolan Ryan came into the game, and the American League had a 200 batting average against him this year. Last season, the American League hit 187 against him. Outside. I think what amazes me about that statistic, Tom, is the fact that his earned run average was over 3, even though the league hit only 187 against him.
Yeah, it really is amazing. I think one of the things that Nolan will walk, well, about a man every 3 innings, and they get in scoring position.
Fouled off.
Because a fast runner has a good chance of stealing when they get on first base against him, and a clutch base hit will score that man. Of course, he has given up some home runs, too. Like the White Sox hit 4 home runs off him in that one ball game. But it is amazing. You would think that his earned run average would have been far below 3.
One ball, 2 strikes. 2 outs, a man on. Scott Fletcher batting here in the White Sox 5th. Strike 3 called. Ryan strikes out the side in the 5th. No runs, no hits, a walk, 1 left after 4.5. No score in Arlington. Director Skip Ellison, this is Jim Durham and Tom Pishorek here in Arlington. Only 1 hit in this game, and that was a little bloop single by Ron Kittle over Rafael Palmeiro's head. Strike call. I'll tell you what, Melido Perez has won the respect of Tim Wilkie, the home plate umpire.
That's a questionable pitch right
yeah.
there. Certainly not. It was unhittable. Pitcher's pitch all the way.
Ball 1, strike 1 to Pete Incaviglia. Leading off the 5th for the Rangers.
We talk about hits in this ball game, Jim. There have been 5 good swings taken the whole game by either team. You know, not to be derogatory about the hitters, but the pitchers have been that good.
Ball 2, strike 1. That's the first time since I can't remember when that a pitcher has been behind in the count, either Perez or Ryan. For Perez, maybe, since the first inning when he walked a couple. The 2-1. Fouled away. Ball 2, strike 2.
Melito showing confidence right there in his slider as he broke it down and away from Incaviglia. Didn't get a good swing, so he's back even in the count at 2-2. I'd look for the split finger right here. It's been his bread and butter pitch all night.
In the hockey game tonight in Chicago Stadium, the Blackhawks trail the St. Louis Blues 1-0 in play in the second period. The 2-2 pitch to Incaviglia. Ball 3, strike 2.
Well, it was wrong again. He went with the fastball. You know, he's had as good a command, probably better command with the split finger pitch than he has the fastball. So let's see what he does 3-2.
Melido Perez has retired 10 Rangers in a row.
It's a split.
He got him. Incaviglia not happy.
Oh my, this looks like a slider right here. Look at the movement. It is, that can't be a strike. You can't hit it. Melito pretty happy with the call right there. I'll tell you what, well, there's 16 strikeouts in this ball game so far.
That's
and we
right.
are in the 5th inning.
Nolan Ryan, when he struck out the side in the top half of the inning, that gave him strikeouts numbers 8, 9, and 10, and for the 200th time in his career he struck out 10 or more. He struck out 19 once, well, more than once.
most guys don't strike out 10 in any one game of their careers, and good pitchers too.
2-0 the count to Gino Petrolli. 19 strikeouts out of 27 outs in the big leagues. You know, you hear stories of little leaguers that strike out 20, 21 guys.
Sure.
In the big leagues.
Nolan Ryan does that in the major leagues. Gives you that illusion of that little league baseball. And we're talking between innings too, Jim. Nolan Ryan with 92 victories, 8 away from 300. Had he been on a good offensive team in any of those years, he'd be closing in on 400 wins, I believe.
Probably. Long drive into the right field corner. The first hit of the game for the Rangers, and Petrolli has a double.
Stayed on the inner half. Gino Petrolli's an excellent fastball hitter, especially down in the strike zone, as that pitch was. Location not that bad, but to a fastball hitter like Petrolli, not that good of a pitch. So Scott Kulba, and he grounded out his first time up, will be the hitter with one out.
Petrolli with his second two-base hit of the season. Strike. 0-1 to Kulba. That's a good sign that Melido came right at him and got that first strike in. You know, sometimes a pitcher's sitting out there, everything's going along, peaches and cream, and then somebody hits a hard hit ball off of him, and maybe he loses concentration a little bit. But Perez jumps ahead in the count. First time the Rangers have had a man in scoring position since Palmeiro was at second base in the first. Inside, a ball and a strike. Tuesday night here, Texas won it 5-4. Last night here, the White Sox won it 5-4. Now in the fifth with one out, Melido Perez gives up his first hit. Each team with a hit. Two, strike one. Scott Kulba, who came in hitting 111. Two and one, one out, one on. Hit hard, foul.
Oh, he got that one up a little bit. That was a split finger pitch. Good play there by the ball boy. And even up again at 2-2. Mike Stone, who is the president and chief operating officer for the Texas Rangers, wants to say hello to his mom, Norma Stone, in Michigan. I know he's watching the ball game. So hi, Norma.
It's a game situation right here, the way Ryan is pitching. Foul down the left field line. Still two balls and two strikes. The Rangers with a man in scoring position. And in a scoreless game with Nolan Ryan working on 10 strikeouts already, one run could be very big. Melido Perez, being matched against a future Hall of Famer, has really risen to the challenge tonight. He's come up with his best effort of the young season. Two and two to Kulba. Jeff Houston is on deck. Ball three, strike two. We talked about it earlier. Jeff Torborg, starting pitchers in this series, have done pretty good. Count. chased that pitch in the dirt.
And that is strikeout number 7 for Melido Perez. Looks like a slider. Look at it right here. He's not going to give in with the fastball on 3-2. Coolbaugh does not recognize any kind of rotation. So he's the seventh strikeout victim for Melido Perez. And Jeff Houston, the shortstop and number 9 hitter in the lineup, is the batter.
He is 0-for-1, grounded out his first time.
It's a big out, too, because we talked about it in the first game. Houston was able to get a walk late in that ball game in the 8th inning. And what that did was enable Sierra and Franco and all those big hitters in the lineup to hit it in the 9th.
Good point. Strike call.
So anytime, that's what a big part of what your 7th, 8th, and 9th hitters, the importance of them, Jim, in the lineup is for them actually to get on base any way they can, so to enhance the probability that the 3, 4, and 5 guys are going to get the hit, especially in the 8th and 9th innings with the game on the line.
One strike on Houston. Ball 1, strike 1. Gino Petrolli, the runner at 2nd, had the 1-out double. Perez with 2 strikeouts so far here in the 5th. He's trying to match Ryan, trying to strike out the side. That's what Ryan did in the top half of this inning. Here's the 1-1 to Houston. Fouled it back. 1 ball and 2 strikes. That backswing by Houston evidently caught Carlton Fisk.
Hudge not having a real good night. Well, there you see that extent. Oh, my, he nailed him. Like Mike Tyson hitting you with a right cross or whatever. My goodness, that's why those helmets come into effect right there. Those catchers that don't wear those helmets, they really leave themselves open. Take a brutal beating. That's not enough. You get the ball. Now you get the bats hitting you. Whoa.
If you don't have that helmet on, you could end up with bats in the belfry, right? Here we go.
Yeah.
1 and 2. Houston laid off that outside pitch. 2 balls, 2 strikes.
Well, the White Sox are playing him like as if he were a right-handed pull hitter. There's a huge hole there in right center field between Lance Johnson and Sammy Sosa. As you can see, my goodness, like about 40, 50 yards.
He's giving signs at second base.
Yeah, it's big enough you could drive a yacht through. I say yacht because there's enough water out there in that outfield.
Uh-huh.
The White Sox are concerned about Petrolli stealing the signs.
Yeah, that's what they're saying. We heard it with our camera right there by the third base dugout, picking up a lot of things the White Sox players are saying, and they're saying that Gino Petrolli, being a catcher, would know a lot easier than the rest of the guys on the team.
Plus, he's been out there. He's been out there long enough that he's.
That's very true.
He's seen a lot of signs.
Yeah.
In this, these 2 sequences, these 2 batters.
Well, you give the signs. A number of ways of giving it too. You can give location by signaling with your hand, right or left. Pudge doesn't give it away though too easily.
Foul ball.
Whoa, good play by Pudge getting out there, trying to get that easy out. But what they'll do at second base, and of course it's much easier to hit knowing what's coming. Of course, with that split finger fastball that Melido Perez has tonight, it's still going to be tough to put the ball in play with any type of velocity on what you hit. But Carlton Fisk, see, he's going to change things up. A little wiggle, 1, 2, 3. I don't know what he's doing. But a lot of the ball being called. Yep, Melido made some movement towards home plate to start his motion, and that's what they called right there on Perez. So the block moves the runner to third base. Well, we really can't tell. Well, there's Melido on the side. Geez, I didn't see anything there.
I didn't either. But anyway, on the balk, Petrolli is at third, 2 outs. 2-2 the count on Jeff Houston.
And now he can't tell Houston what's coming.
Right, he can't steal the sign now. Fastball. Base hit. The Rangers. by Jeff Houston.
Two out RBI. That's what makes or breaks good teams. The teams that can score the most runs with two out usually are the contending type ball clubs. Two strikes on him too. That's a nice job of hitting by Houston, who has never been known for his bat. Came over in a trade from the Montreal Expos.
Came into the game hitting 238. Steve Lyons having to step over the diving Houston on that snap throw over. Two outs, a man on first. Gary Pettis the batter, 0 for 2, has struck out twice. Melido Perez being touched for two hits in this inning. And the game's only run. Big chop up the middle. Fletcher to Ginn. And that's it for the Rangers in the fifth, but not before they come up with a run. On two hits, they leave him in. After five full, it's 1-0, Texas. White Sox down 1-0 as they come up here in the sixth inning. Ozzie Guillen to lead off against Nolan Ryan, who has 10 strikeouts already this evening. Nolan Ryan, in his stint with the Astros in the early to mid 80s, had spent occasions on the disabled list with some various ailments, but usually was pulled muscles in the legs and that sort of thing. Right back at him by Ozzie Guillen. That's the hardest hit ball off Ryan in this game.
Nolan Ryan shows you the kind of fielder he is too. I'll tell you what, that ball was hit like a bullet right back at him. Fortunately, it's to his glove side, and he was able to make the play for Nolan anyway. Watch how he becomes a fielder. See, he gets pretty square. But the ball, if he throws a fastball and you hit it right back at him, there's not a whole lot of time to react. It's a good play. Great play.
Lance Johnson pops it up. Shallow left. Houston out. Two quick outs for the Sox in the sixth. But at least Lance Johnson makes some contact.
Well, Nolan averaging two strikeouts an inning up until this point. You know, we talk about those 5,000 strikeouts, Jim, but the thing that's amazing about Nolan, to me, more amazing than that, is that in 47, almost, well, actually, over 4,800 innings, he's given up a little more than 3,500 hits. So that's 1,300 hits less than innings pitched in a career. That's mind-boggling. Look out, Sammy. Curveball. How do you do that?
I don't know, but I'll tell you what.
He's got to have 400 wins at least with those numbers.
Yep. Oh, fastball. He couldn't catch up with it. It's a ball and a strike. He's doing now, Tom, what we said early on. His velocity is just what it was in the first inning, if not then some.
Oh, yeah.
They've got about 20 pages of Nolan Ryan in their press book. Couldn't catch up with a fastball again. Good old country hardball here to Sammy Sosa.
Oh, yeah, well, he wasn't a very good hitter. He only batted 110 in his career. Nolly did. Trying to look up something to give us a shot here.
In 1986, Nolan did have some elbow problems with the Astros.
Yeah, I thought that.
There's a curveball that hangs high inside.
And they limited his pitch.
Yes, they did that
pitch
year.
Pitch number every time. He didn't like that.
Well, that was the year, of course, that the Astros won the division. In 84, he had some blister problems on the right hand. He had a pulled calf muscle in 84. He was on the disabled list. There's a high, long drive into left. Cavilla over and makes the catch. Another three up and three down inning for the White Sox as Sosa flies to deep left. After five and a half, 1-0 Rangers. No disguising the fact that Nolan Ryan has been at his future Hall of Fame best in this game. The Rangers leading the White Sox 1-0, and Palmeiro leads it off here in the sixth inning for Texas. Strike at the knees. Palmeiro 0-for-1. Ryan got the White Sox in order in the sixth, but they hit the ball on him.
Yeah.
Guillen hit a rocket right back at him for the first out. And Sosa flied to deep left.
That is a good sign, though, really. I'm not saying that he's losing it or anything, Jim, but the fact that the White Sox are able to put the ball in play, yeah.
There's a high drive, foul, and out of play.
You know, Sammy Sosa just missed hitting that pitch out of the ballpark. It was a high fastball. I think Nolan wanted to get it up and out over the plate. He got a little bit in. Sammy able to pull it, but just got underneath it a little bit. There's Sammy. And nobody's been able to take advantage of that wet grass out in the outfield. Tough for those guys to get a good jump when your feet are slipping out from under you.
One ball, two strikes, the count on Palmeiro.
Oh,
outside.
My.
Tough ball, two, pitch. Strike two. Lake Arlington out there.
Yeah. And it's a lot wetter than it looks out in that outfield. Very well kept field here, though, at Arlington. Jim Anglia, he's right in that Roger Bossert mold.
Fly ball to left. Calderon is in. Palmeiro is out. One down for the Rangers in the sixth, and here's Julio Franco.
Well, there you see it, 0-for-2 for Julio. And the big hitters in this Ranger lineup haven't done anything. It's been the bottom three, actually the number 7 and number 9 hitters who accounted for the only run, Petrolli with the double and Jeff Houston, shortstop, with the single, number 9 hitter.
Yep, after Petrolli was balked to third, ball one, the count on Franco.
Well, the balk really didn't come into play because there were two outs at
That's
the time.
Right.
That ball would have been a hit anyway.
Yep. Ball one, strike one.
With one out, though, that would have been huge because then he could score by either, didn't have to get a base hit, in other words, to score him.
Franco began the game hitting .237. Swing and a miss. Ball one, strike two. So after Melido Perez was nicked for that run in the fifth, he's come back every bit as solid here in the sixth as he's been throughout the whole game.
No doubt, Julio Franco, one of the better hitters in the American League, has not taken a good swing against Melido yet.
Hit hard off foul down the third baseline. Well, we get another score in the hockey game at Chicago Stadium. The Blackhawks have taken the lead, 3-1 against the St. Louis Blues.
Whoa.
And of course, if that lead holds, the Blackhawks lead the series 3-2. It's playoff time in Chicago. I wonder if that Blackhawks fan knows that the Hawks are ahead 3-1. You want to go down and tell
him,
Tom?
Yeah, I think I will between innings. Oh, my.
Oh boy,
this.
Franco chases another one out of the strike zone. He has struck out three straight times tonight.
And he has the hat trick.
Yes,
we're
sir.
We're talking about hockey. There it is. I'll tell you, Melito Perez has made Julio Franco look as bad as I've ever seen him. That was a cut fastball or slider up and away, and that pitch is a foot out of the strike zone. Julio pulling his head really badly all night long. He's got that hat trick. Number 8.
18 strikeouts in this game. Sierra, the batter. Flied to left in the fourth. Fastball strike. White Sox games are always more enjoyable with a group of your friends or colleagues. For more information on single game sky suites, special group rates, picnic and patio parties, call the White Sox sales office at 924-1000. That is 312 area code, of course. Two strikes here on Sierra.
Oh boy, I'll tell you one thing. Tim Wilkie has been consistent all night with his strike zone, but he has got a very large plate, by evidenced by that last pitch to Sierra. Large, wide, tough to hit.
That is a ball. One and two.
Hey, that last pitch wasn't too far away from that exact spot. Of course, we got the camera angle. It's not directly behind the pitcher, so we may not get a real true perspective of it, but it's going to be close.
Okay, the 1-2 pitch. Fouled. Still a ball and two strikes to Sierra. Well, I've just been informed regarding the Blackhawks score against the St. Louis Blues that the three goals that the Hawks scored, they did it in 2 minutes and 16 seconds. And that is the Stanley Cup record.
Whoa.
The old record for the three goals scored in the shortest amount of time was 2:36. 1-2 to Sierra. Ball two, strike two. Three hits total in the game. One run. The run belongs to the Rangers as they bat in the bottom of the sixth. The 2-2 pitch from Perez to Sierra is lined into center field for a base hit.
Well, Melido finally made a mistake to Sierra. He got a split finger pitch up and out over the plate, really hung up there. Sierra, the great hitter that he is, you see the high leg kick, while up and away. Just a tad out of the strike zone, but it was up. The key to the split finger pitch, naturally, is to get it around the knees or below.
There's last year's look at Ruben Sierra.
Yep, look at that year.
And you, my friend, were the man who in May and June you were already touting him as the MVP in the American League.
Yeah, I really felt like he should. Well, he had an advantage over everybody else. First of all, he's young. He could play every day. Played 162 ball games last year. In Texas, that's tough to do because of the heat factor during the summertime. Switch hitter has the advantage. And he's got great power and great abilities from both sides of the plate.
Strike call to Harold Baines. It's a ball and a strike. One more time tonight, at least. The White Sox will have to go through this part of the Texas batting order.
Wayne Edwards starts to warm up in the Sox pen. He's a lefty.
Ruben Sierra, the runner at first, with two down here in the sixth inning. As Tom mentioned, the left-hander Wayne Edwards working. One ball, one strike, the count on Baines. Little low. Ball two, strike one. Sierra is not called on to steal much, but he can.
Oh, he's got great speed. But you know what? One thing he doesn't know how to do is slide, believe it or not. That's the only thing I could say bad about Ruben Sierra, is the fact that when he goes to slide, he almost stops before he gets to the bag. Therefore, it takes him that much longer to get there. And he's called out a lot of times stealing bases and running the bases as well.
Two balls and a strike.
He's one of those guys. I mean, there's no reason to think he's only got one stolen base so far this year. Why he couldn't steal 40 bases in the season. Ken Seiko says he's going to steal 50.
Yeah, I heard that. Good stop by Fisk. 3-1. And Cavilla on deck.
Well, also, when you have those power hitters on deck, hitting behind you, Baines and Cavilla, a guy like Sierra isn't called upon to steal that often, because he can score from first base a lot of times on in-between doubles, even long singles sometimes if he gets a good enough jump. He can fly.
There he goes. Strike called. A stolen base.
Well, with Bobby Valentine, it's an automatic 3-1 or 3-2 in a situation that he is going. I don't know, Ruben looked like he really wasn't all that enthusiastic about leaving that time. He may have thought the count was 3-2 there. You see him almost stand up right there saying, wait a minute, Harold, you got to swing at that pitch. And there you see a kind of a lousy slide in the second base. He didn't get there really quick.
Yeah, but the dirt is damp.
Yeah, that's true.
You can't. Your slide won't carry very far unless it's a wet infield.
That's two stolen bases on the season now for Ruben. And Carl Fisk with Baines and the right-handed hitter coming up next. They're going to talk things over. Well, you've got to know the sign, too, because Sierra has just gotten to second base.
That's it.
Change the signals. And, of course, try and make a perfect pitch here to Harold Baines with first base open.
So 3-2. The Rangers in the fifth inning came up with a big two-out hit to score the game's only run. And Baines takes ball four. Now it's in Cavilla.
Well, that's the third walk for Melido Perez, but he was just trying to ace him with a great split finger pitch right there. He bounced it. Harold didn't bite. So runners are at first and second now. Two outs for Incavilla, but Incavilla is probably the guy they don't want to face in this situation because he has been red hot at the plate. And you see the Knight thrown out on a great play by Robin Ventura. That was back in the second inning, and he struck out on a questionable call back in the fifth. He was called out.
But in the first two games of the series, the White Sox have felt the sting of Incavilla, winning the first game of the three-game set on Tuesday night with a two-run homer. Oh, good pitch. Strike one. Now the right-hander Don Paul working in the White Sox bullpen along with Wayne Edwards. Two innings in a row that the Rangers have had a threat here against Perez. They pushed across the run in the fifth, and now they have runners at first and second and two outs here in the sixth. The one strike pitch. 0-2.
That's a great pitch right there. That thing went down right at the last possible second, right around the knees. Down and in. You don't really get away with that pitch down and in very often to right-handed hitters, because usually they have to, all they have to do is drop the head on the ball, on the bat, of the bat on the ball. That had just such great rotation and movement. Inky had no chance.
Perez way ahead in the count, 0-2. Petrolli on deck. The pitch to Incavilla. Good stop by Fisk.
Well, he does that great, doesn't he? In fact, he gets in front of those balls and he deadens them right at home plate so nobody can advance. He just does it so well for so many years. You really just expect this to happen. See, he wants a split finger and he wants it down. He gets it a little bit too far down.
Carlton took it right off the chest protector, kept it out in front of him. 1-2. Here we go. Ball two, strike two. Melido Perez with the walk to Baines here in the sixth. That's his first walk since he walked two in the first inning tonight. Sierra the runner at second, Baines the runner at first. Strike three called. Incavilla called out on strikes. For the Rangers in the sixth, no runs, a hit, a walk, and two left. And as we go to the seventh, the Texas lead is 1-0.
Rangers 1-3-0, White Sox 0-1-0. Here as we go in the seventh inning, and all kids attending the White Sox Blue Jays game at 1:35 on Sunday, April 29th, that's this coming Sunday, will receive a Kenner starting lineup action figure of one of your favorite White Sox players. For tickets, call Ticketmaster at 312-559-1212. And remember, it's only a 40-minute drive from Arlington Heights to convenient Comiskey Park.
Over 20,000 here tonight, 20,404. Curveball high to Yvonne Calderon.
Big inning for Ryan, Jim. This is the seventh, the meat of the order coming up for the White Sox.
Fastball popped up. Petrale wants it. One down.
See, now there's a play right there that would have been really tough on either one of the first two nights. There's no wind in Arlington Stadium tonight, so Gino Petrale had a fairly easy play. The other night, that ball would have been doing the boogaloo coming down. It would have been a tough play for anyone.
Here's Ron Kittle. He has the only hit against Nolan Ryan tonight. Sort of.
Yep. It wasn't pretty, but it still counts.
Oh, swings through the fastball.
Actually, the best chance the Sox had at getting another hit was that shot that Ozzie Guillen hit right back at Ryan. Terrific defensive play. That's the defensive play of the game for the Rangers.
That's right.
Oh, my.
Two strikes on Kittle, and Petrale was setting up inside. And Ryan blew it by him outside.
Well, when you have that kind of velocity and that kind of stuff, you can make a mistake with Nolan Ryan. A lot of pitchers can't afford to do that. Kitty is very solid on the outer half of the plate.
Got a piece of it. Two strikes. A very cool evening here in Arlington. 66 degrees now. And the breeze has picked up, Tom. That wind that you put up with for the first two games of the series, it's picked up a little bit, blowing in. Ooh. Breaking ball gets him. That's 11 strikeouts for Ryan.
Guy's running out of K's out there. There you see the curveball. Kitty looks like he's right on. That ball pretty much went straight down. Didn't have that big arc to it. Didn't start it out at the right-handed hitter's shoulder. Pretty much over the plate and straight down. So Kitty goes down. Two out here in the seventh. Herm Schneider consoling him there on the White Sox bench. He's probably saying, don't worry, Kitty, I couldn't hit that pitch either. And Herm, you're right.
Not too many guys are hitting that pitch tonight. Ball one to Carlton Fisk. Coming into this game, Ryan had 17 strikeouts in 19 innings of work. And now in his career, he has averaged over 9 strikeouts per 9 innings.
Oh, wow.
Well, this 11 strikeout performance, of course, will move him well ahead in that endeavor. 1-1.
Look at the concentration. Oh, my. Scary.
Foul ball.
He hung that inside. He ripped it down the third baseline. Nobody really got away with the pitch right there.
He's so good, though, Tom. You almost think maybe he wanted it right where he got it, because he knew all Fisk could do was hit it foul.
That's very true. That's very true. A little bit of inside. Now he's ahead in the count, 1-2. What do you throw here?
Fastball away.
Nope.
Curveball just misses. 2-2.
He kind of backed on him, up on him, too. It didn't really break away like he wanted it. Petrale set up on the outside corner. As you can see, there it is. Straight down. Just missed.
seventh inning stretch, and Texas in front 1-0. The A's lead the Orioles 5-4 in the ninth. California Angels and Red Sox tied at 4 in the ninth. Seattle a winner over the Yankees this evening, 6-2. Cleveland beat Toronto 4-3 today. And Milwaukee nipped Kansas City 3-2. Those are the American League scores. In the National League, the Cubs winning at San Diego 3-1. Pittsburgh won at San Francisco 2-1. And Houston shut out Atlanta 3-0. And a new pitcher for the White Sox here in the seventh.
Left-hander Wayne Edwards comes on to work for the Sox. No record, a fine 2.25 earned run average in his rookie season. He's appearing in his sixth ball game tonight. He doesn't have any saves left yet, but he has done a nice job in four innings, giving up only one run on two hits, walking three and striking out four. So he's got the major league fastball, excellent curveball, and he will change speeds, turn the ball over with his changeup.
The first man to face him, Gino Petrolli, the Texas catcher who doubled in the fifth and scored the game's only run. He's backing out on that curveball, but it's a strike call.
What an outing by Melido Perez. 9 strikeouts, only 3 hits given up in 6 innings. Best one of the season for Melido.
Unfortunately, he was matched against perhaps the greatest right-hander of all time. And Nolan Ryan was coming up with that kind of Hall of Fame effort tonight. Ball 2, strike 1 to Petrolli. Getting some activity in the Texas bullpen as well.
Mike Jeffcoat, left-hander. Oh my, there's a good curveball by Wayne. Petrolli chases it. You know, Gino only had 9 at-bats against left-handed pitching last year, but with the game ahead at this point, he's going to hit. Of course, he's doing a good job catching Ryan. There's Mike Jeffcoat. Good left-hander. Bobby Valentine likes him a lot.
Ball 3, strike 2, the count on Petrolli. This game in the home seventh with the Rangers leading 1-0. Oh, Edwards barely missed with that one. A little bit high, evidently.
Well, right there, Edwards fell in love with his breaking ball. He's got a good enough fastball to throw at the major league hitters. A bit surprised they went with the 3-2 breaking ball. So Coolbaugh, the hitter, fun situation. I'm sure Bobby Valentine would like to get an insurance run here in the seventh inning. Houston on deck. Of course, he's a left-handed hitter as well.
Coolbaugh struck out in the fifth against Perez. That was the inning the Rangers scored their run. He struck out just ahead of the big two-out hit by Houston. Strike 1. Well, we understand the St. Louis Blues have gotten one of those goals back now, and it's 3-2 Blackhawks. Third period, I assume. Scott Coolbaugh, strike 1 the count. Ventura is in at third. Strike. 0-2. Well, you would also assume the bunt is now on.
Well, you'd think so. He didn't appear to be bunting on that last pitch.
No, he didn't.
You don't have a lot of speed there with Petrolli at first. He did score the only run in his ball game. He will not be stealing.
And Ventura,
total surprise.
Ventura backed up at third. Foul tip. Still 2 strikes on Coolbaugh.
And I'm really wondering, Jeffcoat is warming up as if he's, you know, fixing to go into the game, James. So I don't know if something is wrong with Nolan Ryan.
Well, he had that slight muscle problem, you know, in his last outing against the Yankees. Leg muscle, maybe it's acted up. It is a cool evening. Swing and a miss. Coolbaugh strikes out.
Strikeout number 1 for Wayne Edwards. He just throws this fastball right by Coolbaugh, way out of the strike zone. That's about neck high. So Houston will bat. He's the hitting star so far tonight for the Rangers with that RBI single. And that was back in the fifth inning, the only run in tonight's ball game. There you see it.
When Ryan left the game against the Yankees the other day, it was cramps in the right thigh. That's the only thing that would slow him down tonight. Strike. 0-1 to Houston.
Well, he's got a bad leg. You would think that some of the White Sox hitters would try maybe a bunt or something to get him to maybe hurt himself at least. Even if you don't get on base, you're doing something for the team by getting him out of the ball game.
I tell you, Tom, it's amazing. You and I commented on it when the White Sox had one inning where they actually hit the ball. It was remarkable. I mean, that's the kind of performance he had tonight. He was so overpowering.
That's very true.
And we're speaking of him in the past tense. We don't know that officially, but with Jeff Coat working in a hurry in the bullpen, you assume that Nolan is done for the night.
And the Sox have been in double figures the last two nights as far as the hit total. Had 10 on Tuesday and 10 on Wednesday. There's Bobby.
And they've got one tonight. Breaking ball outside. Ball one, strike two.
Gary Pettis on deck. Looking at pretty much of a platoon situation at shortstop with the Rangers right now, Jim. Jeff Kunkel playing against the left-handed pitchers. Houston against the righties.
And Houston hits a double play ball to second. There is one, and Ozzie's relay in time. So the Rangers are retired in the seventh. No runs, no hits, a walk, nobody left. We go to the eighth. Texas up one. Nolan Ryan out there on the mound for Texas. Even though we saw Jeff Coat working in a hurry in the bottom half of the seventh in their bullpen. Jeff Coat is still loosening in the bullpen.
Well, if he was a little ouchy, maybe coming out there to warm up, Jeff Coat would be called in for this ball game. I think that's what Bobby Valentine might be thinking. Didn't want Jeff Coat out there cold because four of the next five hitters from the White Sox standpoint are left-handed hitters. Get the lefty up.
Steve Lyons being one of them, and the breaking ball, he swung, strike one.
Mm-mm. Can't help a great pitcher by swinging at pitches in the dirt, but it's very tough to lay off Nolan Ryan's curveball because, as we talked all night, he's got such a sharp break to it.
0-1 to Lyons. He struck Lyons out in the fifth. He looked at a call third strike. Ball one, strike one. Cardinals and Dodgers are getting out. In Los Angeles, St. Louis scored a couple.
Ooh. And that his shoulder. So wish him the very best. Oral Hershiser is certainly one of the real star players in all of baseball today. Oh, my. Tell you what, see, that's what the great option that Nolan Ryan has. Like, the last three curveballs had just been spinners out of his hand, aside from the first one that he threw in the dirt. He can always come back with that circle change, breaking down and away, the exact opposite action of that curveball. Good command of it so far tonight.
2-2, the count on Lyons. Fly ball, left field line. Out of play. Still two balls, two strikes. White Sox home tomorrow night. Toronto Blue Jays at Comiskey Park. The scheduled pitchers for that one: Greg Hibbard for the Sox, John Cerruti scheduled to pitch for the Blue Jays in the front end of that weekend series at Comiskey Park. And then the Rangers come in for a four-game series starting Monday. Strike three call. Team strikeouts for Ryan.
Oh, my. Well, there you see a dewdrop. Well, it actually wasn't that great of a pitch, but it just froze Steve Lyons for an instant. And that is 13 by my count here.
That's what I have, 13.
Yep.
How about this? he started the game. Nolan Ryan started the game, had 17 strikeouts in the American League. That left him tied for fourth. Roger Clemens came in tonight's statistical breakdown, had 32 strikeouts, and Ryan now is only two behind him. He's got 30 strikeouts on the season now.
30 strikeouts, and seven of those have been called third strikes. A lot of strikeouts tonight with that breaking ball, just paralyzing the White Sox hitters. Downer just misses.
Ball two, strike one. Robin Ventura, one of those strikeout victims who took a call third strike. Fouls off the fastball. Two balls, two strikes.
It's important for Ryan to have a good inning from a Ranger standpoint, because just like we talked about the other night, when the to turn that batting over order over, get those 3, 4, and 5 hitters to bat in the ninth inning, the White Sox are going to have to get a couple base runners on here in the eighth inning, even if they don't score. You want to get the Calderon, you want to get the Fisk and Kittle.
There's 14. Yeah, he's really losing it as it goes along, Tom.
No, I think he's checking in at about 95 right here. Look at it, breaking up.
Oh.
Well, moving up and away to Robin Ventura. He goes after it. His head went down and tried to make contact, but that is number 14.
And four in a row.
Yes. He's not getting any weaker, that's for sure. Mike Jeffcoat might just take a seat. Jeff Russell's up there now. He's their number one guy out of the bullpen, their closer.
Oh, Fletcher fouls it right here.
Boy, and you bailed out of there
with
like
that one. Actually, it went next door.
Good shot. There he is.
Just missed us a little bit.
That was not Louis Aparicio bailing out of there. That was Jim Durham.
I learned that from you, Tom.
Yes. I always get hit by those. That's the thing.
Ball one, strike one.
You'll get yours soon.
Here's a look at that Ranger bullpen. Russell, the right-hander. Jeffcoat, the lefty.
As the Hawk would say, it's double-barreled action.
There you go. And 1-1, the count on Fletcher. Two balls and a strike. Nolan Ryan has allowed just the one little hit by Kittle, or he would be real close to his sixth no-hitter. At the knees, 2-2.
Yeah, it seemed insignificant at the time. That was back in the second inning where Kitty got that little flare over Palmeiro's head.
And you know, you commented on, you thought that Palmeiro got his feet tangled up going for it.
Yeah, I really
did. What if he catches that one? Then we really have something here.
Oh, boy.
Over 20,000 buzzing. Ryan with a 2-2 count to Fletcher. Strike three called. He strikes out the side in the eighth. He has struck out five in a row, and he's got 15 Ks working. 1-0 Rangers. A spectacular fireworks show follows the White Sox-Tigers game on Saturday, May 19th at 6:05, sponsored by Miller Lite. For tickets, call Ticketmaster at 312-559-1212. The top of the order for the Rangers in the eighth. Gary Pettis leads off against left-hander Wayne Edwards. Nolan Ryan, with his 15 strikeouts, has tied his Texas Rangers club record, which he set last year. Strike at the knees to Pettis. He cannot, however, equal his all-time best, which is 19.
Well, if we go extra innings, he can.
Well, yeah, that's true. But not in a nine-inning game. 0-2 to Pettis. Well, they are in the third period at Chicago Stadium, and the Blackhawks lead the Blues 3-2, and Pettis goes down swinging. A lot of K's in the air tonight.
Oh, my. Well, Melito had 9. That's a second one for Wayne Edwards. He really pulled the string on this one right here. It looks like takes something off his curve a little bit harder. You might want to call this pitch a slider down and into the righty. I'll tell you what, that's a great pitch. Lefty to right-handed hitter. I think the down and in slider just out of the strike zone with 2 strikes is the best strikeout pitch that he has to offer.
26 strikeouts total in this game.
That's got to be somewhere near a record, isn't it, for 9 innings?
Strike call to Palmeiro.
Well, we're not even done with 8.
That's right. Palmeiro walked in the first, fouls it off. Nothing in 2. Nolan Ryan, who always draws well when he pitches, after an all-day rain here in North Texas, a crowd of over 20,000 showed up, and boy, have they been treated to a classic pitching performance. Ryan has 1 hit, the White Sox, and the Rangers have only 3 hits against Perez and Edwards. Now the Sox grounded down to Fletcher. Palmeiro is thrown out. 2 outs for the Rangers in the 8th.
Tell you what, Jeff Torborg has got to be proud of the job that Melito and Wayne have done tonight. They have just been outstanding. Melito Perez established that fastball early in the ball game, as well as the split finger pitch. And Wayne Edwards, after a little bit of a rocky start with walking Gino Petralli, his first batter, he has really settled in and has done a nice job with his fastball and assortment of breaking stuff.
Well, Tom, it's taken a Hall of Fame effort by a future Hall of Famer to hold the White Sox in check to this point. I mean, they've been right there competing with him.
Melito struck out Julio Franco. He's got the hat trick right now. Number 4, you know what the number 4 is? 4 in a row strikeouts? It's the infamous golden sombrero, which I have worn on a number of occasions.
1-1, the count on Franco. A long drive to left. Calderon reaches up and makes the catch. Franco flies out to end the 8th. Nolan Ryan going to the mound here in the 9th, and Texas has a 1-0 lead. Cool night. The White Sox have run into some Texas heat, and I mean full blown. The only thing separating Nolan Ryan from a chance at his 6th career no-hitter is a little flare in the 2nd off the bat of Ron Kittle.
Hit it right off the end of the bat. And as we commented between innings, Jim, that ball started off over Palmeiro's left shoulder, and then it kind of hooked back over his right, and he just wasn't able to get his feet together to make the play.
Ozzie Guillen leads off the 9th. And hits the fly ball to left. 1 out. That at least ends the string of 5 consecutive strikeouts by Ryan.
Well, the White Sox need a base runner right here. Lance Johnson with the good speed. If he gets on base, I got to think he has got to try and steal second base, because you just can't rely on getting 2 more hits to score him. So Lance, a critical batter for Nolan Ryan right now. He's 0 for 3.
He has struck out twice. Popped a short the last time up. Fastball strike.
Just a laser right on the outside corner. He has lost nothing. I'm sure that gun down there is registering about 94, 95 miles an hour.
0-1. Ball 1, strike 1.
Fans getting a little greedy. That pitch only missed by about a foot.
Ryan trying for his first complete game of 1990. Ball 2, strike 1. I don't know about you, Tom, and I, you know, it's never fun, I guess, when it's happening to you, but yet you have to have such a great respect and appreciation for this performance we've seen by Ryan tonight.
Absolutely. Ooh, there's the ball just a little bit low, so Lance Johnson has that favorable count, 3-1.
And Pasqua is on deck for the White Sox.
Oh, put some power up there. I think Lance has got to take this pitch.
3-2.
Got to try and get a base runner on Ryan. Chances are he throws that bullet just out of the strike zone. You're going to pop it up. So 3-2 now. Big pitch.
Nolan Ryan has retired the last 10 batters. The big crowd alive. Fly ball left center. It's into left field, actually, and there is Incavilla making the catch. So here's Pasqua batting for Sosa. The last hope for the White Sox against Nolan Ryan.
Of course, Danny has that great power, certainly capable of tying this ball game up with one swing. Jeff Torborg going with the percentage here, hoping that the left and right situation will work out for the White Sox. Sammy Sosa was 0 for 3 with 2 strikeouts. Although he did swing the bat well his last time up, he flew out to deep left field.
Most of the people here in Arlington on their feet. Ball one to Pasqua. Curveball over. 1-1.
Do drop in right there. There's the Ranger bench.
Curveball misses inside. Ball two, strike one. Here we go. 3-2.
Circle change. That's a great pitch right there. 3-1. Danny Pasqua obviously sitting on that number one. He got to be thinking fastball. And now he's got to have that pitch in the back of his mind right now. What do you throw him here?
Let's watch it. Nolan Ryan one hits the White Sox with a 16 strikeout performance. A new Texas Rangers strikeout mark, breaking his old record, which he set last year. He's out of the gate in the American League season with 4 straight victories. He's only 7 away from 300 wins for a career. And maybe he has never been more overpowering than he was tonight. Perhaps even in his no-hit games was he more overpowering than this, Tom.
Well, he had great command of all of his pitches tonight, Jim. He had 3 great pitches working for him. We talked about in the opening, the overpowering fastball, the outstanding curveball, and that circle change has just made him a monster out there.
Some performance. 1-0 Texas. We'll recap in a moment. Well, the White Sox's finest pitching performance of the young season is for naught as they ran up against the Hall of Fame candidate Nolan Ryan, and boy, was he at his all-time best tonight. 16 strikeouts, gave up just 1 hit, a second inning looper by Ron Kittle that just made it over Rafael Palmeiro into right field, and as Tom mentioned, if he hadn't got his legs crossed up here going for it, he might have caught that ball.
Yeah, right there. If he was playing just a little bit deeper, too, he had a chance of making it. Ryan made the defensive play of the game when he caught that hard shot right back at him by Ozzie Guillen. Ozzie had the best shot of getting a hit, and that was the only play that anybody had to make for him. He was just that good. There's Nolan Ryan right there. You know, the White Sox have nothing to be ashamed of tonight. They were overmatched offensively. Pitching was terrific with Perez and Edwards.
So Ryan wins it. He's 4-0, and he gets 16 strikeouts in the process. We'll close it out in a moment.